John said, he is precious. By leaning on his bosom, so for a moment may I humbly testify.
Give Jesus a hand clap of praise in his house. Did I mention? Whew, I'm about to get wound up, folks. Did I mention that I love him? How I worship and adore him. When I could see no way, he made takes away. Did I mention he's been faithful to every promise? Not one has it come back to him void. To every promise he's ever made me. Someone tell me one time, they said, "Pastor, I don't stand up in church and testify because I'm scared I'll say the wrong words." All you need to say is, "I love him this morning. And he's been faithful." That's all I need to say. That's all I need to say. Don't need a bunch of fancy words or all elaborate. We don't need just that I love him. Oh, he's faithful. Whew. Amen. You know, how many of you have siblings? Yeah? How many of you ever looked at your mom or dad and said, "Well, I'm the favorite"? Yeah? How many of you are the baby of the family? We're the favorites because mom and dad found perfection and stopped with us. Amen. Right? But I'm glad today that all of us can say I'm his favorite. Because even if I was the only one on this earth, he would have still went. And he would have still died. I love him this morning. I praise him for what he is doing in the life of our church. Had someone tell me the other day, they said, "Pastor, it is so different now than it's ever been." And folks, do not ever think that that's an Adam Griffin thing, because it's not. That is you all saying, "All right, Lord, here we are. Here we are. We're going to get out of the way and just let you do your thing." And he is. And man, has it been sweet in the process, hasn't it? And I told Sue and I were having this conversation the other day. I said, if you think this has been good, I don't think we've scratched the surface of what God's going to do at Richmond First Church of the Nazarene. I believe that he is getting ready to blow the lid off of things. And I am thankful to be a part, just a little part of it. Amen. It's Palm Sunday, and I had a thought cross my mind the other day. I was talking to a friend of mine who is, he was actually my boss when I worked at the Toyota dealership in Madison. Greg and I have been friends for probably about 15 years, and he's one of my dearest friends. And he'll call me and vent. He's the sales manager of the Toyota dealership there, and he'll call and vent to me, and I'll call and vent to him, and we're just that friendship, right? And I know Mark and I know Ronnie can probably attest to this. One of the worst things about working in the car business are tire kickers, right? Now, for those of you who have not worked in that business, tire kickers are the people who show up just to kick tires. They do. They take your time, and they never once intended, from the time they stepped on the car lot, never once intended to buy a car. And you say, do people really do that? Yes. They do a lot. I'll never forget. I could go on for hours about my year and a half almost at the Toyota dealership. But we had gotten a brand new Toyota G6 in, which those are pretty rare for small dealerships to get. They're a little sports car, And we got that in, and I had a guy stop in. He was in a suit and tie. I thought, he's going to buy this thing. You know, I'm going to get a pretty good commission check off this here in just a minute, you know. And he's like, I want to drive it first. I was like, okay. So we literally pulled it off the showroom floor for him. He gets back, and he's grinning from ear to ear. I'm like, oh, I got him hooked. Yeah, yeah. I said, well, let's go in and have a seat at my desk and see what we can do. And he looks at me and goes, oh, I'm not buying it. And I said, excuse me? He says, I've just always wanted to drive one. It wasn't a G6, it was a Supra. Sorry, Toyota Supra. And don't get me wrong, that thing is fast. But I couldn't believe it. I mean, it's not easy to squeeze those cars between the desks, much less through those doors that are supposed to be wide enough to pull a car through. And he got back in his Mercedes and left. And Greg came out to me. He goes, what's that all about? And I said, And he goes, don't tell me he just wanted to drive one. I said, So we get it back in on the showroom floor, and he pulls all the salespeople together. He goes, from now on, we make sure they're here to buy this Supra and not just drive it before we go through the hassle. He said, not to mention it's an expensive car and they don't need to drive it unless they're buying it. Deal. So that led me, talking to him this week, it brought back that memory. And then God started taking that memory and building a sermon out of it. And I'm like, oh, this could be good. And then as the week went on, it got gooder. And gooder. And gooder still. And I'm like, woo! How many of you know somebody that does this? Not buying. Just looking. I'm just looking. I'm not buying. You will see how this all comes circle here in just a minute, all right? Y'all are looking at me like, all right, how in the world is he going to tie this into something spiritual? I promise you we'll get there. Just be patient. Turn to Mark chapter 1 if you want to read along with us this morning. We're going to read of a very familiar, you know, if you read your Bible, I always say it's a very familiar passage of Scripture, a very familiar story. But if you don't read your Bible very much, you ain't got a clue about this story. So I'm not going to pretend like you do. So we're just going to read. Jesus has gone to Simon Peter's mother-in-law's house. You can imagine how that went down, right? I mean, you take the Savior of all mankind to your mother-in-law. Yeah, there's hope yet, right? I'm going to take and pray that he can just do something, right? So he goes to Simon Peter's mother-in-law's house, and she's sick, all right? So the scene is now set. He has touched her and healed her of a ravaging fever. And we pick up the story here. In Mark chapter 1, we're going to start at verse 21 of what takes place as soon as we go through here, all right? Where we start, he hasn't healed her yet. I'm sorry. We'll get there. It's all in the story. Just listen. They went to Capernaum, and when the Sabbath came, Jesus went into the synagogue and began to teach. The people were amazed at his teaching because he taught them as one who had authority, not as the teachers of the law. Just then, a man in their synagogue who was possessed of an evil spirit cried out, "What do you want with us, Jesus of Nazareth? Have you come to destroy us? I know who you are, the Holy One of God." "Be quiet," Jesus said sternly. "Come out of him." The evil spirit shook the man violently and came out of him with a shriek. And the people were also amazed that they asked each other, "What is this? A new teaching and with authority. He even gives orders to evil spirits, and they obey him. News about him spread quickly over the whole region. As soon as he left the synagogue, they went with James and John to the home of Simon and Andrew. Simon's mother-in-law was in bed with a fever, and they told Jesus about her. So he went to her, took her by the hand, and helped her up, and the fever left her as she began, and she began to wait on them. Go figure. She just got over it. She's already waiting on them again. That evening after sunset, the people brought to Jesus all the sick and demon-possessed. The whole town gathered at the door, and Jesus healed many who had various diseases. He also drove out many demons, but would not let the demons speak because they knew who he was. I want to draw our attention, and Randy, if you will, put verse 33 back up there. The New Living Translation adds a couple of words to the end of this verse. The whole town gathered at the door, and the NLT puts "and watched." Okay? Why else would the whole town gather at the door of Simon, Peter, and Andrew's house when all of these were coming and being brought to him and being healed? Why else would they show up other than to watch, right? How many of you, when you are sitting in your living room and there are lights flashing outside, go to the window and become the world's biggest creeper? You're doing that whole... I saw a meme on Facebook, said when the cops are at your neighbor's house, this guy is on the roof with his vacuum cleaner. But you do, you're going, what's going on over there? The night of the tornado warning a couple weeks ago when Winchester was hit, we're sitting on the front porch of the parsonage, the sirens are blaring, you know, and that's me. Tornado warning, Adam's outside looking for it. But in the midst of all of that, we heard a bunch of sirens coming, and they turned on Sylvia Nook, and they went to that first house. And I mean, they were in droves, 4 or 5 Richmond police officers. And we're sitting there doing that whole, we're rocking on the front porch swing, just a tornado going on, we're watching over here. And we watched, and Sarah goes, what do you think's going on, Dad? I said, I don't know. Well, can we walk that way? I said, there's a tornado coming. No, we're going to sit right here on the porch like good Midwesterners. And we watched, and we watched, and we watched, and eventually they left, and, you know, life went on. But when something's going on, we like to know what it is. We become the nosiest people on the planet, right? When you see maybe the Lowe's truck pull out in front of your neighbor's house, I go out and I go, what are they getting? Oh, a new fridge, huh? That's pretty. Oh, look at that. I remember, man, years ago, our neighbor, the Watson's truck pulled up out in front. They unloaded this massive hot tub. And I'm going, I wonder if they're going to invite me over to sit in the hot tub with them. You know? But the whole town gathered at the door to watch. I want to ask you this morning, are you of the crowd that is just looking, or are you buying in to what the master was doing inside? Are we just looking, or are we buying this morning? What's it going to be? I'm going to start this off like this. You can't do both. You're either going to be all in for Jesus or all out. You can't say, oh, well, that looks good. I'm going to go down to the first church of the I got to be careful. Randy yells at me when I get outside the camera screen. I'm going to go down to the first church of the Nazarene, and I'm going to look in the door because I hear something's going on down there. Well, praise God, that news is spreading around town. But here's the thing. I'm glad you bought that because you're here. I praise God that you found out that what you heard about is really going on. And you said, man, I want to be a part of that. I praise God for that. How many of you were a little resistant when you first came to Jesus? How many of you ran from that for years before you finally gave in? Yeah. Right? You heard about it? And were you a three-time-a-year? Easter? Mother's Day? Christmas? Mother's Day because you had to show up for mom, right? Or maybe you, maybe your mom had already gone. You were a two-timer. Easter and Christmas. That's when I go to church. And you know what? The roof didn't even cave in. Huh. Are we just looking or are we buying? Folks, we need to make a decision this morning because time is running out for others to buy in. It is time that we start to look at our family and at our friends and at our neighbors and at our coworkers and at our nurses and at our doctors and at our bankers and saying, listen, it's been high time. You've been looking. But how about you put your money where your mouth is? Let me tell you about my Jesus and what he can do in your life. Can I tell you that there are two younger people sitting in the crowd here today who can tell you about what buying in to Jesus can do in your life. They were strung out on drugs for years, and they're sitting here this morning. Whew. There's a difference between just looking and buying, and we need to tell them that. Let me tell you, I was strung out on anything you can imagine. If it was a drug, I took it. Yeah? If it was a drink, I drank it. If it was a sin, buddy, I did it with my boots on. And I looked good doing it. Yeah? That sound like anybody here? But what happened? What happened? Did you finally get to the point that maybe you remembered that that Toyota Supra was at the Toyota dealership? And you know what? I think I'm just going to pull the trigger. I'm going to go down there and buy that thing today. And you cruising around town. That's about how I'd be with a 2024. What color? Camaro. I'm training you well. Woo-hoo-hoo, yeah. Ralph and I would be, I'd call him up and say, let's go. You're going to take your orange Mustang. I'm going to take my orange convertible Camaro, and we're just going to go ride around town, and Greta and Bev can just sit there and look pretty all the way. Right? Sounds like a good idea. Yeah. Are we just looking? Are we continuing to live our lives closeted as Christians, or are we telling people you need to stop messing around? During my year and a half of selling cars, I had a guy come in on three different occasions over a month time, and he looked at the same vehicle every time. He drove that vehicle all three times he came in. Finally, the last day, and I knew the guy, I knew, not well, but I knew him enough that I could look at him and say, okay, you've looked at it enough, it's time to buy it. And he looks at me and he goes, you think so? Yeah, my paycheck depends on it. He goes, probably not going to find one as nice as this, am I? I said, nope. Why do we ask car salesmen those types of questions? Of course you're not going to find one nicer anywhere else. They're going to lie to you all day long. But honestly, he was looking at a beautiful Toyota Camry that was, it was in great shape. Beautiful. And I told him, I said, listen, if you don't buy it, someone else is going to. And you want it or you wouldn't have been here 3 times. So why not just buy it? He said, you know what, Adam, why don't we just go in and sit down at your desk? And I was like, oh, thank you, Jesus. And I sold him the car. It's about high time, my friends, that if you this morning are still just kicking tires with Jesus, that you need to give in. It's high time this morning that you say, you know what, Lord, I've heard about you. I've tasted bits and pieces of what you can do, but I want to dive in deep. I want to give you my everything. I want to give you my all so that I can have the full buying experience. It's about high time that we look at our neighbors and our friends and our, your lost kids, your lost grandkids, and say, you know what? It's about high time that you quit kicking tires. In Matthew chapter 21, we read about today. The disciples went and did as Jesus had instructed them. Well, what did he tell them to do? He told them to go into town and that they would find a colt, right? Tied up there, and which is amazing in itself. It was right where he said it was. And he told them, if the owner of that colt asks why you're taking his colt, tell him that the Lord has need of it. And they did. They went and untied this guy's colt. And he says, hey, what are you doing? And they said, the Lord has need of it. And the guy goes, okay. In my mind, I'm going, listen, if somebody showed up and started to steal my truck, and they said, what are you doing? They said, well, the Lord needed it. Who? I would have thought the Lord would have gave me that direction, but who? And he's just like, okay. So they went into town, and they did as Jesus instructed them. For they brought the donkey and the colt and placed their cloaks on them for Jesus to sit on. And listen to this. A very large crowd spread their cloaks along the road, while others cut branches from trees and spread them on the road. The crowds that went ahead of him and those that followed shouted, Hosanna to the Son of David. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest heaven. And when Jesus entered Jerusalem, the whole city was stirred and asked, who is this? And the crowds answered, this is Jesus, the prophet from Nazareth in Galilee. They had a parade when Jesus came to town. I want to draw your attention to the fact they had a parade when Jesus came to town. And this wasn't just the local folks in Jerusalem. People had come from miles around to see him. They gathered along the road where he was coming, and they were taking their cloaks and putting them on the road in front of him so that his donkey didn't have to walk in the dirt. That's how important to him, or to them, he was at the time. But might I divulge for just a moment and say that they were more interested in watching him than hearing him, than letting him change their life. You see, they were just looking. Just like they were standing outside of Peter and Andrew's house, they were just looking at what the master could do and not buying in to allow him to do it for them. How do I know this? 5 days later, they nailed him to a cross. They didn't buy. They were just looking. That same group of people, 5 days later, when given the choice to release Barabbas, the most notorious murderer of the day, or Jesus, chose Barabbas. What are you doing? Are you just looking? Are we like those in the streets of Jerusalem that day who said, you know what? I like what I'm hearing. I like what I'm hearing about him. Sounds good. But you know, I just don't know that it's for me. How many of you have people in your life? Think about it right now. How many of you have people in your life who have that exact mindset? It sounds good. I like the way it sounds, but man, this serving Jesus stuff. I don't know. Remember when you were like that? I remember when I was like that. But oh, do we have a story to tell? Oh, do we have a story to tell? James puts it like this to you and I today. He says, do not merely listen to the word and so deceive yourselves. Do what it says. Anyone who listens to the word but does not do what it says is like someone who looks at his face in a mirror and after looking at himself goes away and immediately forgets what he looks like. But whoever looks intently into the perfect law that gives freedom and continues in it, not forgetting what they heard, but doing it, they will be blessed in all that they do. My friends, this morning, that is a bedrock promise from the Savior of all mankind that if you will just do what you've heard, buy into this, realize that this is real, and continue in it, you'll be blessed in all that you do. Can I stand here today and testify to that? Has it been easy? Nope. Not been easy along the way. There have been hard times. There have been disappointments. There's been heartaches. There's been sorrow. There's been sickness. There's been death. There's been all of these things that have happened along the way. But can I stand here and tell you today that even in the midst of everything hell has tried to pull me away with, my God has been faithful every single minute and every single mile along the way. Amen. I'm not just looking. I'm buying. I'm buying. Because it's true. Everything about it is true. I want to remind you that if you would say this morning, well, Pastor, you know, I'm just not ready to give my life to Jesus, or I'm not ready to share what he's done in my life. Can I share what Jesus said about you? Matthew chapter 7, verse 21, he says this, not everyone who says to me, Lord, Lord, will enter the kingdom of heaven, but only the one who does the will of my Father in heaven. It's not just about looking. It's not just about liking how the preacher preaches. It's not just about liking what the preacher said. It is about giving everything we are to Jesus and selling out and saying, yes, I'm buying into the goodness of God. It is about then us going to all of our friends and all of our family and all of the people that we know that desperately need a Savior and saying, listen, it's about high time that you start listening. It's about time that you respond to what I've been telling you. The time is coming. The day is drawing near when that eastern sky is going to split wide open and he's going to come back. Where are you going? Are Are you buying? Or are you just looking? Went to Big Lots the other day, and we were looking for a new recliner. Just a recliner. They don't sell them for fat guys anymore. They don't. Every one I sat in, I had to go. I felt like a hot dog. This ain't comfortable at all. A little Big Lots girl, she said, "Can I help you, sweetheart?" I said, "I'm just looking, but I don't think you have what I want to buy." And she said, "What's that?" I said, "A fat guy's recliner." It's the best way I can describe it. I don't know. It's big. It's cushy. It hugs me. Ugh, that kind. And she says, "Well, that right there is all I got." I said, "Sorry, I ain't buying." So we went down to the big Richmond Bargain Center down there in front of the movie theater. We went in there, and I asked that guy, I said, "Did they stop making recliners for big guys?" And he goes, "No, I just can't keep them in." I said, "Well, hint, hint, buy more." He says, "Oh, but we've got this this love seat that has dual recliners on it." He said, "Just sit." I said, "Man, I don't have room for that." He said, "Just sit in it." Can I tell you it's in my living room? I sat in it, and I went, "Oh, yep, I'm home." And then Greta goes, "Oh, look, sweetheart, we can sit together and hold hands while we watch TV now." And I'm like, "Yeah, we can. Yes, we can, sweet pea. I will hold your hand through This Is Us, all the way through it. Yeah, I can." A guy said, I said, "Well, you got a $1,200 price tag on this thing. It's a catnap. Anybody ever heard of that brand? They're made by Ashley. But these things, I am not kidding you. I understand what a catnap is now. Whoo! I mean, you sit on this thing and it's just like, wow, you know? And it's one of those that when you lay back, it lays all the way back. And I about fell asleep in the store." And I said, "Well, what will you sell it to me for?" He said, "Well, the price." I said, "No, that's your asking price. What will you sell it to me for?" Isn't that a good car salesman line? Yeah. People hate when I come in anymore because I've been down that road. "Well, what will you sell it to me for?" "Oh, I could probably knock 100 off of that." I said, "Quit wasting my time. Have a good day." "Oh, whoa. I could probably come down to $999 plus tax." I looked at him. I said, "That's $300. You've got to listen to $1,299. So you're telling me that if I come in and say, "Yeah, I'll buy that for $1,200, you're ripping me off. You liar." And he goes, "What?" I said, "You say bargain center right over the front door." "Yeah. So if you go in there, talk to them. Don't just buy what they say." So I tell you what I'll do. I'll give you $1,000 out the door. Tax included. Out the door, I'll give you $1,000 for it. Because it was worth that. I knew that. He goes, "Okay." And then he goes, "Well, do you have something to take at home in?" I said, "No, I got to go home and get the truck." And he says, "Where you live?" He said, "I'm going on lunch." He delivered it to me and helped me carry our recliners that we had out and helped me carry it in, helped me move the other couches to make room. I went in just looking. I came out with a whole lot more. Came out with a couch that was highly discounted. And I got moving help. Isn't that the way Jesus is, though? Isn't that the way Jesus is? You just came looking for salvation, something to save you from hell. But then he just keeps adding the blessings once you buy him. Tell people it's time. Today is the day to to quit playing games. Today is the day to buy in. Trust me when I say it's worth it. Stand with me this morning. So are we going to throw a parade for Jesus today and crucify him on Friday? That's the question I have for you today if you are just looking. Are you going to be part of that crowd that one day is, oh yeah, Linnell, if you will.
Oh yeah, man, Hosanna, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Praise God, hallelujah. Oh yeah, here he is.
And 5 days later, nail him to a cross. He hasn't done anything but crucify him. Today's the day. Quit looking. You know, the old phrase is to go or get off the pot. I'm going to clean that up a little bit because I got in trouble. I got in trouble for saying but from up here last week. So, you know, that phrase says go or get off the pot. You know what it really says? Yes. It's time to make that decision. Are we going to really give in to him? Are we really going to tell our loved ones and our friends and our family about the goodness of God and how much he loves them? Why are we still looking? Let's buy into that today. Let's be the ones that even when they were crucifying him, we were still crying, Hosanna. We were still in love with Jesus. Listen, you're not going to get that kind of support out there by any stretch of the imagination. That's why we gather here every Sunday. It's to join together to be encouraged and filled and it's good, isn't it? So how about it today, friends? Anybody before we go say, Pastor, I've been looking for a long time. Long time, and it's time that I buy into this, that I give him my all, and here I am, Lord, take me. Here I am. Anybody this morning, I want to give you the opportunity to make sure that you bought in, that you got your ticket punched to heaven, and that you're going to make it there one of these days. I'm not going to hold you long. We got to get set up for a good old Southern Gospel group here in just a bit. But how about it, friends? Anybody this morning that just would say, Pastor, here I am. Here I am. How about anybody who says, you know what, Pastor? I do have loved ones that are not saved. I have friends who are not saved. I have neighbors who are not saved, and I'm going to make a vow right now that I'm going to tell them about Jesus this week. That I'm going to tell them that it's time that they quit kicking tires because their time is running out. Anybody make that vow this week? What a better week for you to tell your neighbors, your friends, your coworkers about Jesus than Holy Week, right? So let's make that vow. Lord, I'm going to do that this week. I'm going to tell my neighbor. I don't even like him. But I'm going to tell him about Jesus this week. Lord, that coworker drives me up the wall and down the other side. But I'm going to tell them about Jesus. Lord, that nurse, man, she was kind of rude. Maybe she needs to hear about Jesus. It's time, my friends. It's time. You like what God's been doing here? Imagine what would happen if each of us go out of here today and tell one person about Jesus. And then they start coming. Ronnie and Molly, I was thinking about this week. You know, the first time we met was at the Kingsman concert. And y'all have missed one Sunday since then.
one Sunday. And then they brought Mark and Vicky, and they told Doug and Wanda about us, and they're here. Imagine what if all of us would do that. Say, man, God is doing something down there at the Nazarene Church that I can't even put into words. Come and be a part of it. Praise God. And then they come in and they find Jesus. Oh, whew. There's our revival we've been praying for, yes? Tell them to quit kicking tires. Father, today, we praise you and we thank you. But Lord, one day we gave in. And you held up your end of the bargain. Not only did you hold it up, you surpassed your end of the bargain. Because, Lord, man, what you've done for me since then is just amazing. Lord, help us to go out of this place today to invite somebody to come to the concert with us tonight, to invite somebody to come with us Wednesday night, next Sunday. Father, whatever it is, to tell them that it's time to give your all to Jesus. Lord, help us to do that, to be faithful in that. We thank you, we praise you for your presence in this place today. And we give you all the glory, the honor, and the praise. In Jesus' matchless name, amen.